Okay, this is, well, this is officially weird. I've been wanting to do this since I was a kid. Now I'm here. I can't quite take it all in, but anyway, listen, I'm in Zurich. We are we're backstage at the biggest airfield I think I've ever seen. Now, you know, I've been to a few festivals over the years, you know, with Virgin Radio. And the thing about a festival is what, you know, normally there for the weekend, a whole load of bands playing. Not this one. This is like one band playing. What, maybe 2-3 hours? So, as we work our way down this corridor here, down this corridor to where we're going to do the interview. I haven't got enough hands to open all these doors. Can you help us with that? Yeah, just thank you. This is where we're going to be. I'm going to sort of throw a few facts and figures at you. 335 people here just to get this show on the road. That's 126 trucks. They pack it all up. They fly along to the next place. Generators producing enough juice to power a small village. And a video wall. Well, this is the Rolling Stones. So you're talking a big video wall. It's the biggest one ever made. 426 bits of pyro. A show that could really only be put on by the Rolling Stones. Now, as we work our way down, it's like a massive sort of compound area, really. There's everything you could wish for here, everything you could possibly want they've got backstage. There's bathrooms over there, that in there, that's a gym. Okay, if you want to have a workout before you go on stage, you can get yourself in there. There's a pool table. If Ronnie wants a game of pool before he goes on stage, he can have a game of pool. There's a band's restaurant. That is the restaurant in there tonight. What you got on the menu? Pan-fried salmon on a bed of balsamic mushrooms. Very nice. Anything you want to drink, Stones have got it for you. It's called the Rattlesnake Inn, by the way, their restaurant, which is very nice. We'll eat there a little later. And down here, well, this is where we're going to be interviewing the Rolling Stones for the next couple of hours. So let's go in, let's get set up, and we'll crack on with Mick.
Hello, Mick.
Hello, Ben.
Nice it is, nice to meet you.
How are you, Ben? I'm fine.
See you. Thank you very much for coming in and giving us your time.
All right, Ben.
Right. Thank you very much.
How's that looking?
That looks good to me.
Probably get louder as it goes on.
Good. All right.
Good echoing in.
Welcome home, the Rolling Stones. Exclusively on Virgin Radio.
Welcome home, Mick Jagger.
Hello, how are you, Ben?
I'm very well, you?
Good.
So, well over a year on the road, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling pretty good at the moment.
Going well?
Yeah, it's going well right now, and Ben and I are talking. I'm in Zurich. Well, Ben's in Zurich too.
Yeah.
Switzerland. It's been raining all day, but
I brought the wrong shoes, Mick.
He's got his sandals on.
Yep.
So you can take those off and just go barefoot in the grass, I think.
I think so. So by the time this goes out, you'll be back home. Are you looking forward to playing the UK shows?
Yeah, it'd be great. Was supposed to be Wembley, but now Twickenham, where we played before. It was actually a really good gig.
Yeah, actually, Charlie was saying he really enjoyed Twickenham.
It was the first time we played it, but I think it was the first time it had been used as a gig at that time. And, it was a very compact stadium, so there was a lot of people in there.
I thought the acoustics were great.
Yes, because it's a good, and you felt like it wasn't too enormous, you know, like the old Wembley. It was a great stadium, but you did feel it was an enormous space, which it was.
I was going to ask you, do you ever get used to this kind of schedule? But then I thought, well, actually, you've been doing this for longer than you can probably remember, so this is all you really know, isn't it?
What do you mean?
Relentless touring.
Yeah. Well, no, I had a lot of times when I didn't do it, and, you know, I think we had good time off in between, so that I think the trick of it is not to be relentless. I mean, it may appear to you to be relentless, but it's actually planned so you get quite a bit of time in between, because I think otherwise you go a bit nutty.
Do you get nervous before you go out on stage?
Nope, I never get nervous, except I get a bit, before the first show of a major tour, I get a bit anxious, because I think, you know, you don't know what's going to happen, you don't know what the audience is going to be like, you don't know if the songs are going to be, you don't know if the lighting, it's not just you don't, you know, will the band play well, will I sing in tune, you know, will the lights work, you know, will the gimmick work, whatever the gimmick is that year, you know. But there's also things that, you know, like the sound system, I mean, there's lots to go wrong, and of course, you know, things do go wrong, and the first nights they do tend to go quite wrong, but people hopefully don't notice. But I'm a bit anxious, and then after I get one night, usually I don't worry.
Welcome home. The Rolling Stones, exclusively on Virgin Radio.
On this show, I get to meet heroes of mine, and I'm amazed over the years where I've met all these artists. You're the only one whose voice, I think, gets better with age. I mean, Roger Daltrey, God bless him, by his own admission, will admit that his voice is getting a little bit weaker. Now, when I saw you in Milan, I don't think I've ever heard you sound
better or stronger.
Well, that's very complimentary of you. I mean, to be honest, I don't think I was... You know, when I started out, I used to smoke, you know, like everyone else and all that. And I mean, I gave that up a long time ago. But I think I just worked at it a bit, you know. And then I did a bit of voice coaching a few years ago. And we had only 35 years without any voice coaching. You might say, it was a bit late than never. A bit of voice coaching and a bit of warm-ups that I do, which really helps, I think. So... You know, I always tell these younger singers now, you know, like I did it. Like, I never used to do it either, you know. But lots of people do have voice problems, not just older people, but younger people. And I speak to Joss Stone and all that. Like, you know, because a lot of the time you sing a lot, you know, like every night singing for hours and hours and hours. Yeah. And it's tiring and your voice gets tired like anything. So it's like running every night or something. You will get tired. And so that's why you've got to warm up properly. So I just learned that. So maybe that's helped me a bit.
Virgin Radio.
This has been a pretty eventful 12, 18 months for the Rolling Stones. You as ringleader have at times, I think, have had a pretty tough job keeping the band, not together, but on the road, really. Do you feel that without you being, as I say, the ringleader, things would have sort of fallen by the wayside a little?
Well, let's say if I'd have got sick, it might have been a bit of a disaster.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm just saying, well, it's my turn now, is it? You know, you get that sort of feeling that, wait a minute, I'm surviving this, nothing's going wrong with me, you know. But, I guess I was just lucky and nothing happened to me and... You know, I didn't fall out of any ladders or anything or get ill. So I think that, you know, you have to keep, if somebody's a bit, that's the thing about a band, it's kind of like a support system, you know, everyone encourages each other. So if you have somebody that's a bit off or they're sick or whatever, you know, the rest of them have to, you know, be more together and be more supportive of them. So when Keith came back, when Charlie was ill and then he came back to playing, you know, we were very supportive of him and very encouraging, you know, we didn't take the piss or anything.
He said your drumming was very good. Very good keeping time.
Yeah, I had to play drums in the absence. Well, thank God for Pro Tools. And, you know, but...
do it once and then just loop it.
Yeah, exactly. I was a bit like that. I did a bit of both, you know, but...
Yeah.
But, so you have to be really supportive and see how people are and encourage them. You know, Charlie was really good, but, you know, he felt it's a lot to do with confidence, you know. So it's the fact that he was very good, that's if I'd have been like, oh, yeah, come on, then just do better than that, can't you? I mean, it wouldn't have been the right approach at the beginning, because even though he was very good, you have to still encourage him, oh, that's really great. And but he did play really well, but nevertheless, you've got to say, well, you are playing really well and you are doing well, so that, you know, you have that. And the same with Keith, you know, and... It's a lot of it in your head. You know, yes, your body is maybe not a bit out of practice and all this, but a lot of it is in confidence. And when you go up, like, if you start playing football or something like that, when you go out there in front of the crowd, it's not really your ability only, it's the bottle you've got, you know, and you have to have a lot of bottle, you know, to go out in front of 50,000 people and play anyway. So if you're feeling a little bit underconfident, you need all your mates around you to encourage.
Welcome home, the Rolling Stones.
Now, who had the foresight to book Twickenham? Because that's a smart move, because obviously you booked Twickenham for the same time you were supposed to play Wembley, and obviously when Wembley didn't happen, you just moved to Twickenham.
Well, I don't think it was a big dark secret that Wembley was behind schedule, was it? I mean, we all knew, everyone knew, so we were all booking backup gigs, to be honest, including the, you know, the cup final.
Yep.
And we knew... Everyone knew in the business that this stadium was well behind. And, you know, we were looking forward to playing it. There was other bands booked in before us. I mean, Bon Jovi was actually the first
June, band. I think, yeah.
Yeah, they were booked in, and Robbie Williams was also booked in.
Yep.
And we were next. And then we thought, oh, well, maybe it'll be ready, but, yeah, there's no way. And you know, as you know, while we're talking now, we don't know if it's going to be ready for next year's cup final. Right. And so it's a bit of a shame, really. It's a shame. It's not really sort of scandalous, really, because, you know, I'm looking at, like, 3 or 4 stadiums every week, you know, and there's a lot of new ones. And I don't know why our one's not done.
Arsenal did theirs on budget and on time, and it's ridiculous, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, we've just played in the Stade de France, which is not a new stadium, but that was... done for the World Cup previously.
Yeah.
That was all done on time. It's a beautiful stadium. I mean, we just played in the Ajax Stadium in Amsterdam. That was all done on time. Beautiful stadium. You know, we played in the Detroit one, which is a copy of that. I mean, there's so many. And there's some of them, oh yeah, a few are late, yes, but this is like,
really late. It's ridiculous. But the thing is, I'm quite excited about you playing Twickenham again, because it's almost like you being, you know, back on old turf, you know.
I think at least it's, like, we know Twickenham, it's a part of London, we, you know, have a lot of associations with, and it's a great stadium, so it's not the end of the world playing.
You can probably walk home, can't you?
I can.
Yeah. Now, when Keith was in hospital, we're led to believe it was pretty damn serious, okay? Can you recall how you felt at the time? Obviously, when Charlie was ill, you had Keith there and you locked yourselves away in France for a while to work on tracks that became a bigger bang.
Yeah.
How did you feel when you got the phone call about Keith?
We were on tour then. We were on holiday not very long holiday between tours. And I was in Southeast Asia, actually. I was in Vietnam. Sitting on a beach and I was really worried about it, but you know, I mean it could have been worse. I mean,
probably what I read in the paper was not entirely what you were being told, you know.
Probably not. And you know, I mean, you never, and I think that really the thing was that the truth of it was that nobody knew. When you have these concussion injuries, they always keep you under observation for a long while, so that you don't really know how bad it's going to be for the first 10 days. So that was really the worrying thing, you know, about how bad is this going to be. I mean, what Keith had is a what happens to a lot of people. It's not like a really rare occurrence. You know, it happens in sport a lot. You know, people get kicked in the head in rugby and all that, and they fall down and they get this kind of stuff. So it's pretty common, and the recovery rate is well into the 90% that you completely recover.
But did you ever for a second entertain the idea that maybe your wife of 40 years, your songwriting partner,
my darling wife of the Golden Locks, I thought he's going to be all right, because all the medical evidence would point to the fact that he would be fine. So to be perfectly honest, I thought, well, there's a 5% chance something might happen to him, but you know,
it's Keith, and he was all right.
I thought that he was just pretty tough nut, and he'd make it through, and you know, he seems to be fine. Please allow me to introduce. We're playing night, and we talked about the Twickenham gigs, and we got Cardiff, which is going to be, that's always a really great gig. I love that particular place. We've got Sheffield and Glasgow.
And a great bunch of support acts as well. Do you choose those?
Yes, some of them I choose, and some, you know, I chose a whole bunch, and then we had to rejig the tour so that, you know, we got a lot of dropouts and changes that have, you know, come along. So we've had some great support acts. I mean, we had Razorlight.
Fantastic.
They've just been playing with us last two or three gigs.
Yep.
And we had Simple Minds.
What about Paolo
Nutini?
What do you think of him?
That was actually, I never saw them. I spoke to them.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was joking about them. I was in the paper about me joking that he was Scottish. I never saw them, because when we played with them, the dressing room was about 10 miles from the actual stage.
That's what
we
love about these things.
I haven't seen the stadium yet. I don't know where we're
backstage. This place today is absolutely huge.
It's huge.
When you ever listen to the A Bigger Bang album, it's clear that it's a band who are keen to embrace new types of sound. I think that Rainfall Down is a dirty pop record. There's also elements of classic Rolling Stones on there as well. Do you find that the blues, really, is beginning to become a dying sound in modern-day music, mate?
It's difficult to know how many British bands these days really have a blues influence. A lot of bands, and American bands, some younger bands have a lot of blues influence. You know, they're obviously that. You know, like there's bands that sort of really call themselves blues bands that play like rock. You know, like 2220 or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, so like a blues band.
Yeah.
But then there's other bands like, say, the Kaiser Chiefs that really don't have anything to do with. You know, they never play a blue note really, or sing what you would. You know, this very sort of straight ahead in its rhythmic and musical intonation. So yeah, there are some bands that really don't have any depth, you might say, or any influence of the blues, but then, I mean, I think there's others that...
But there may be a band like Primal Scream who are influenced by you, and therefore influenced by the blues.
Yeah, exactly. So, but I mean, I don't think it's true to say that bands aren't influenced by the blues, but there's always been bands that, ever since the 60s, that aren't very blues influenced. Their influences come from other directions, from more English sources, you might say, more or Celtic or music hall, even, you know, in the material. There's quite a few bands like that now.
It's just that I was brought up on a Sunday afternoon. If my dad was in a bad mood, he listened to Len Coe, and if he was in a good mood, it was the Stones or Bo Diddley or John Lee Hooker. And I think that those artists, not so many people are aware of those artists.
Maybe not. But I think that there is a lot of bands that are aware of blues, though. I don't think it's true to say that musicians, I'm talking about people that, I don't know if your dad was a musician, but you know what I'm saying. But yeah. Musicians are pretty aware that blues exist, and they listen to a band that was influenced by the blues.
It's the heritage of music, I guess, isn't it?
I mean, it's a mixture, you know, most of this music, that rock music, you know, is a real mishmash of all kinds of influences, and I think the blues is still a big influence, but, you know, yeah, they don't go back to the beginning, maybe.
I am the little red rooster.
The demise of Top of the Pops.
I saw that. A bit of the last show. I actually
first and last band to appear on the programme. Are you sad to see it go?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, it was very long running, wasn't it? I mean, I guess it's sort of sad. And I turned it on the other night, and I just turned the telly on, and they had BBC on wherever I was. It wasn't me. And I was singing The Last Time, which I guess was the first time we'd ever been on there.
How do you go about choosing a UK set list?
I don't know, really. I mean, I always look at what we played when we were there before. Not that you know the same people are going to be in the audience, but, I mean, that's at least a starting point. And try and change it at least 50%. Mm. I mean, if not more. But you are expected to play some well-known songs, which you might have played last time. But then you can change some of the... I mean, so half of it's at least half different. So. And then really it's what, you know, we feel like doing on the day, to be honest. Or the day before, I might, you know, sit around and do the set list the day before for a gig like the Twickenham gig.
Did you have a good birthday party last week?
Yeah, I was in, I actually didn't have a party on my birthday, but I have one on after the Paris gig, which is
very nice.
That was a good one.
I'm having mine at the Twickenham gig on the 22nd.
Oh, brilliant.
My 29th, good God, yeah. So I should be bringing the whole lot down there.
Are you bringing a lot of mates?
The wife-to-be, she'll be there.
Yes, I've heard about the tattoo.
I've got three. Once you have, they're like Pringles, once you pop, you can't stop. Seriously, you haven't got one, have you?
No.
No, don't. That one hurt like hell. Listen, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
It's been an absolute honour to meet you, and we are so excited about you coming back.
Thank you, Ben. I'm very excited to come back to England. And nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Thank you, Mick.
Bye. Yeah, I'm about to sit down deep in my heart.